Hello friends, greetings from Dr. S.R. Dandote. Video lectures on lasers are available in three parts. In first part, you can see basic laser principles, whereas in second and third part, there are types and applications of lasers respectively. Currently, you are watching first part, that is basic laser principles. So for any laser, what are the different terms essential, how it works, that will be studied, that will be understood from this first video. So the objectives of this present video lecture are to explain the basic working principles of lasers and to explain about the basic laser action. Thus, at the end of this lecture, learners will be able to understand about basic laser principles, like what is excitation process, what is de-excitation, what is spontaneous emission, stimulated emission, the process of population inversion, etc. And the users or learners will also be able to understand about basic laser action. So let us start with some fundamental concepts. So what is laser? The word laser stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So laser is a source of light, but it is totally different than ordinary source. In ordinary source, the waves have different wavelengths, that means it is polychromatic, whereas in lasers it is monochromatic. So basically, laser is a device which produces highly intense light through the process of stimulated emission. So learners need to understand the importance of stimulated emission. So before we go into the details of stimulated emission, let us see what are the different properties of lasers. Lasers are highly monochromatic in nature. Mono plus chrome, that is single color, single wavelength. So lasers, the wavelength of the lasers is one and only one. The next property is lasers are highly coherent in nature. Here in these two pictures, you can differentiate, you can see the difference between incoherent source and coherent source of light. So in the first image, the waves have different wavelengths, means it is polychromatic, and as it is polychromatic, there is no question about its phase difference, constant phase difference, means it is definitely incoherent in nature. Whereas in the second diagram, the number of waves are having constant or same wavelength, means it is monochromatic in nature. And as far as its coherency is concerned, it is highly coherent, means if we measure its coherency horizontally, that is, for example, suppose this point and this point is concerned and some phase difference is calculated. So if I get the same phase difference between these two points or between these two points or any two adjacent peaks over its length, then if it is found to be same or constant, then this type of coherence is called as temporal coherence. So lasers have very high temporal coherence. Now, if it is studied vertically, phase difference is measured vertically, means in space. So once again, suppose the first wave is considered, and on first wave this point is under consideration having some phase value, and here we have some phase value, and suppose this phase difference is taken. Now if this phase difference is same to the phase difference obtained between these two points, or if it is same between these two points, then these waves are said to be highly coherent in terms of spatial coherence. So remember, lasers are highly coherent nature for both temporal as well as spatial coherence. The next property is lasers have very high intensity, or they are more bright in nature. So as there is amplification, there is increase in the intensity, and due to coherency, it can be said that these waves go hand in hand. That means lasers offers the property of high unidirectionality, or in other words, they have very low beam divergence. Now let us see one by one different definitions. The first is stimulated absorption, or also called as excitation. So for the understanding of these definitions, we have to consider an atomic system consisting of these energy states. Suppose this is lower energy state having energy E1, and this is excited state or higher energy state with energy E2. So under normal condition, an electron or an atom will remain in the ground state, and it will stay in the ground state for infinite time if it is not disturbed. That means the lifetime of ground state is infinity. Now, if the system of energy state is, it receives energy in terms of a photon, energy h nu if applied, then due to absorption of this energy, this electron will move from ground state to excited state. That is, after the end of the process, electron is found in the excited state E2. Thus, this is the process of transition of the electron from ground state to excited state through the absorption of energy h nu, which is equivalent to E2 minus E1. The process is called as stimulated absorption or also excitation. Now, the next is spontaneous emission. So once again, consider the system of energy states E1 and E2, and now through stimulated absorption process, suppose electron is in the excited state E2. So remember, if it is normal excited state, its lifetime is very short, which is of the order of 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. That means only for this short time period, electron is going to stay in that particular state. Obviously, after that, electron will have its transition from excited state to ground state. But during this process, the energy which that electron has absorbed earlier, that energy is liberated as h nu, means it is liberated in the form of photon of energy h nu equivalent to A2 minus E1. So if one electron takes its transition from excited to ground state, one photon is emitted. Now, it should be remembered that if the process is spontaneously taking place, means if the process is naturally happening, then there is no control on the process, and hence the number of photons emitted through this process are randomly oriented. This way, the process which is instantaneously taking place will result into incoherent beam of light, and it will have quite broad spectrum. So this can be considered as disadvantages of spontaneous emission process if it is compared with stimulated emission. Now let us see how stimulated emission process is superior over spontaneous emission. So once again, we will consider an electron in the excited state E2. Now it is thought that this excited state has a lifetime greater than normal excited state. So before it completes its lifetime, if the system is triggered by a photon having energy h nu, which is equivalent to A2 minus E1, or which is exactly same to that energy which the photon would be emitted due to its de-excitation. So if photon having that much energy is applied, then this electron will get triggered by that energy. That means this electron will have its transition from excited state to ground state. So as the process is a stimulated process, during this process one photon will be emitted due to de-excitation process and one photon which was used for triggering purpose. So thus the process results into emission of two photons, and the important is what these both photons are exactly identical with each other. That means their energies are exactly same, they are in phase. The phase of the applied photon and the photon which is emitted due to de-excitation, they are found to be in phase, and thus two identical photons having same energy are emitted. So thus the forced transition of an electron from higher state to lower state is considered as stimulated emission process. Now in lasers, this stimulated emission process is very important, because through this process the number of photons emitted are all identical with each other in terms of their energy, frequency, wavelength as well as direction, and thus this process results into monochromatic, coherent and unidirectional beam of light. Now, as if one photon is used for the triggering of an electron, it results into two photons. These two photons can cause de-excitation of two more electrons and will result into four photons, and due to four photons there will be de-excitation of four more electrons that will result into eight photons which are identical with each other. That means once the process starts, it will result into rapid increase in the number of photons, and thus due to increase in the number of photons, it tends to increase in the intensity of light. So besides stimulated emission, it is necessary to understand the terms like metastable state. Metastable state is an excited state having lifetime greater than 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. That means the metastable state is highly essential for lasers, as due to its existence laser action is possible. Because if there are no metastable states in the material, the moment when electron is excited to higher state, it will immediately result into spontaneous emission. So no stimulated emission is possible. So if stimulated emission process is to occur, there is requirement of metastable state. The next term is pumping source. It is a kind of energy required to transfer electrons from lower to excited state. In order to have suitable laser action, stimulated emission process is required, and for stimulated process to occur, it is necessary to have number of electrons in the excited state, and these electrons are suitably transferred using suitable energy source, which can be either electrical energy, means in the form of energy of electrons, or it can be optical energy, means light energy. So the type of pumping source, which type of pumping source is used, that depends upon the type of laser. The next term is active system. So active system means it is a kind of physical state of the material. That means it could be solid, liquid or gas. If we take example of helium neon laser, in that we know there is a mixture of helium and neon gases. So this mixture of helium and neon gases itself will act as active system, and that type of laser is said to be as gas type of laser. So remember, which type of laser it is, that depends upon the physical state of the active system. So in general, it can be said that active system is a group or collection of ions, atoms or molecules, and its physical state defines the type of laser. The next important term is population inversion. So in this first diagram, once again consider the two energy states E1 and E2. So this number of dots represents the number of electrons present in that particular energy state. So it is also called as concentration of that state, and denoted by N1 for state E1 and N2 for energy state E2. So in the first diagram, it is considered as a normal state, means under normal condition, and therefore we have N2 less than N1. So always number of electrons in the ground state is greater than that in excited state, but this will not give the desired laser action. So in order to have appropriate laser action, the necessary is that N2 should be greater than N1. Means the number of electrons in the excited state should be always greater than that in the ground state. Thus, an artificial situation which will create N2 greater than N1 is called as population inversion. So remember, once population inversion is achieved, then and then only there will be proper laser action. Also, in order to have N2 greater than N1, this excited state should be metastable state. So this way you should remember the linking. Lasers need stimulated emission. For stimulated emission, we need to have metastable state. If metastable state is there, then only there will be population inversion. Now, the next term is, what is optical resonator? It is a pair of reflecting surfaces of which one is completely reflecting, means it has reflectivity 100%, and other surface is partially reflecting. So it can be a pair of mirrors or pair of reflecting surfaces having suitable conditions. So by considering all these terms together, we can easily explain the basic laser action. So for that purpose, we have to consider this diagram. So as you can see here, we have an active system, means it can be solid, liquid or gas as discussed earlier, and it is said to be active system in which there is a condition of population inversion. It means that using suitable pumping source, N2 greater than N1 is achieved therein, and this active system is placed between pair of mirrors, means this optical resonator, one is completely reflecting and other surface is partially reflecting. So using basically three components, that is active system, optical resonator and pumping source, it forms a laser. So any laser needs these three fundamental components. Now how it will work, let us see. Once we start the pumping source, that will result into population inversion, N2 greater than N1, and here the laser action begins. Suppose this is one photon emitted through spontaneous emission, and this spontaneously emitted photon can trigger the stimulated emission, means this photon will cause the excitation of one electron from metastable state to lower state, and these two identical photons are emitted, the process is stimulated emission. Now these two photons will further cause the excitation of two more electrons, and that results into emission of four identical photons. These four photons will cause the excitation of four more electrons, resulting into eight photons, and this way the number of photons goes on increasing, and those number of photons are made to incident on this partially reflecting surface. So little part is given out, but about 95% photons are reflected back. So on their return, again the same process will continue, and the number of photons rapidly increases, which further falls on this completely reflecting surface and entirely gets reflected back, and again number of photons go on increasing when it passes through this active system. Thus this to and fro reflection is achieved with the help of these two surfaces, completely and partially reflecting surfaces, and that results into tremendous increase in the number of photons within very short time period. This way intensity, that is energy density, rapidly increases, and it is finally emitted out of this partially reflecting surface as desired laser output. Thus with the help of this optical resonator, unidirectional highly intense beam of light through amplification is produced, and we get the desired laser beam. So this is all about the basic laser principles. Thank you for watching and wish you happy learning.